decisions. They just have to exert more effort.
Absolutely right. Yep, they have to be able to attend. You know, it literally takes more glucose in their brain to get to that point. So they're much, much more influenced by environment. Not only the environment around the time of that decision, but kind of what their life has been like prior to that point.
And so the same kind of holds true for the person who's found themselves to be intoxicated, and it takes more effort to make good decisions, and they fail to do so, mm-hmm. especially they chose to drink, not thinking about later on that they were going to have to somehow get home.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't exert that much effort into that decision-making process, and yet we hold them to the same accountability.
Yeah, I guess that this, what I said before, I mean, not everyone drinks in their lifetime. There's plenty of people who never get drunk, but everyone is 12, 11, 13. I mean, that's...
Well, most of them don't murder.
Yeah.
So when we look at, I guess, and moving away from that point that I was trying to make, but also looking then at how do we determine some of these murders are gruesome. I mean, it's not just as tragic and as egregious as the one we're all seeing in the news right now, where it was just, we're bored and we want a thrill. Some of these that we're looking at here in Michigan that we're dealing with, these 360 some, are very well thought out and point to some sort of antisocial type bent, I can't think of the name.
Antisocial?
Yeah.
Behavior?
It's not what I was looking for, but. Okay. So how do we look at these people, whether they're 17 or 18, and we see the great deal of effort they've exerted into committing this crime, and somehow we don't say, well, their brains are already developing with this sort of antisocial behavior as the bent already, and do we really think, well, when they reach 25 or 30 or 35, that's not already now in that mature brain to continue to behave that way?
Well, I guess what I'd say is, I mean, there is some broad application of this neuroscience. So what you can say in someone that is of, you know, what 15 or 16, is that there's a lot of malleability here, and there's a potential for change that wouldn't exist at a different age.
But I'll just close, Mr. Chairman, we can't base our decisions in the judicial system and on justice based on the potential of the person to be cure cancer or something else later on in life. We have to base it on the decisions they're making today that they made yesterday, or isn't that right?
Again, I feel like this may be more of a legal question, but my understanding is that if you give someone life without parole, there's some finality to that decision that runs a bit counter to this notion that this is not a fully formed mind, and it's a little bit unknown what their potential is.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Representative Robinson.
Is there a difference between the male brain and the female brain?
Yes, I mean, there is.
No, I mean, I've been all the things I've read, it says the problem with the development of the brain and this control of the id or the superego is a problem for males.
Yeah, I mean, I want to just stick close to what I know best. I mean, I would say that, yes, testosterone does have different neurobiologic effects, but it would be really hard for me to say how much of that is hormones versus environment.
But there is a distinction, because most of these people in prison are men.
Right, yeah, I believe there is a body of literature on that, but I couldn't really summarize it here.
The other thing is, that's all I need to know. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Hearing no other questions, I want to thank you for your testimony today. We're coming up on noon, and I'd like to bring in a few more speakers before that. So, again, let's be aware of the time. Next up is Craig DeRoche from the Justice Fellowship and former Speaker of the Michigan House. Welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for affording me the time. I'm going to invite up Heather Rice Minus, if that's okay, from Justice Fellowship as well.
Sure.
From our staff. I come with some good news for the representative that asked the question about, is there any redemption that exists in the world? And the answer is yes. I work for an organization that was founded by a gentleman named Chuck Colson, who went to jail in Watergate. He was Richard Nixon's political advisor. And when he got out, he thought that that there were things that we could do differently as a culture and as a society in the criminal justice system to increase public safety, to better respect the victims of crime, and to seek the transformation of the people that have broken the laws and make sure they don't break them anymore. We're an organization that believes that there is a role for retributive justice, which is the prison time, but we also focus a great deal of our time in testimony helping legislators work through the more restorative parts of the justice system. Speaking to today and giving a little bit additional background to the members present on myself and the perspective from which I come from beyond my experience here in this legislature and the work I do at Justice Fellowship, those in the House, some of my friends that I served with in the Senate may know this better, but I lost my younger brother last year, September 12, 2012, and I learned a month later, quite definitively, actually about 5 weeks later, that his death was the result of the actions of another human being. It came back in a blood test. He was prescribed drugs from the VA. He was back from Afghanistan, and went in the day he died and complained and said that he thought that he was having heart attacks, and the doctor said, without doing any testing other than to take a blood test, said, you're suffering from PTSD and they're panic attacks, and go home and play video games. And he died that night. He left a voicemail for his wife about an hour before he passed away and said it was happening again and that he was scared. And she found him there when she returned from church. And the postmortem blood analysis confirmed that he wasn't, in fact, taking at prescribed levels. And so me as an older brother and an uncle, and, I had to make that call to my mom, and I had to hear the unreal wailing of pain in her, and had to coach my nephew's soccer, that Saturday, and have him explain to his friends that his uncle was coaching because his dad died. And, I still worry and pray for the one-year-old that he left behind. And I had to reconcile the fact that, he died quite specifically because of the actions of another human being that I don't think is against the law. Perhaps an ambitious prosecutor might call it manslaughter or something like that. But I think as a family member of somebody who had somebody die that was taken in a day at 39 years old, otherwise healthy, by somebody else, that the victim should come first. And I think that what is being lost in maybe some of the posturing of the testimony that this committee is hearing today is that the victims are not place first in our current criminal justice system, and that sets about a perverse set of incentives for us to reconcile. When the Attorney General spoke and gave his testimony about the process, he said three times that the process goes like this. The prosecutor exercises their discretion and their discernment about what they're going to do, and then the judge and the jury, based on the facts, do what they're going to do. At no time did the Attorney General say the victim of the crime advises the prosecutor and the prosecutor takes into account what the victim wants that prosecutor to do, because that is not respected in the laws of the state of Michigan. It's not currently in the substitute that you have before us. Justice Fellowship strongly recommends that this opportunity that's before you, that's been defined much better than I can do for you, on some very now winnowing, narrowing topics as you sort through this, that we're talking about individualized justice, which is something that Justice Fellowship advocates. We are part of the Prison Fellowship Ministries. We believe that every human being is created in the image of God. I'm not trying to put that on the members of this committee or the citizens of the state of Michigan. It's a belief of our organization. But the value that we strive for with our faith and our belief is that justice should be sought individually wherever possible. And that is the burden that is coming down from the Supreme Court toward this legislative body for consideration. But respectfully, I would also ask you to consider it for the opportunity that it is. And I wouldn't want to put any of the family members that are going to speak here through the pain of revisiting what happened to their loved ones. But I know that if I had to attend hearings on what happened to my brother, if I had to mention it in testimony as I'm doing today, as others will do for their family members, for the advancement of justice in this state and in this country, then it's a way of honoring my brother. It's a way of honoring the victims of other things. It's not something that you should seek indiscriminately, but I do think that you have a weighty matter before you. And I think that it's important that when you're considering the fact of justice as it's been described to you today, whether it's be prospective or retroactive, that you are working toward what you believe is intended in the Supreme Court ruling that is saying that the mandatory minimum, which implies that the judges, once the finding of fact was made in first-degree murder, did not apply any discernment or discretion to the sentence that they handed down. That can be the assumption. And while I can represent to you my views on what should be done in the case of my brother in the VA hospital and the doctors involved in his case, that doesn't empower me to speak for other victims as to what they want done with what happened with their loved ones. And I don't believe that the legislature should allow that victims to speak for each other. I believe that it's worth an investment in this state and worth your consideration for you to put in place a process, which is what the Supreme Court is seeking in their ruling, for individualized review, and that is a worthy endeavor, and that the victims of these heinous crimes may very well ask for the sentence of life without the possibility of parole. And I respect that. Our organization respects that. Justice Fellowship believes that that's a valid request from a victim of a crime to pursue. But we also believe that it is a valid perspective for a victim to have a different view other than that, and that perspective of that victim should be given equal weight and individualized consideration for what that victim is going through, because the healing that has to take place, the role of criminal justice in our communities, which this is what it is in Michigan, and we're getting down to the community level, is that relationship between the criminal, the victim, and the community, in that important balance that we strike. So on the areas of individual review and victims' rights, we encourage this legislature to consider the House and the Senate measures that take into account the Miller ruling. And when it comes to retroactivity, I would encourage this body to apply a standard that they believe is just to all the crimes that are under consideration, and to work toward that end. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I'm available for questions.
Thank you. Any questions from House members? All right. The senators are out. They've got some vote going on today. I don't know.
I'll be available after lunch, but I know that lunch always limits the questions, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate that.
It does. Thank you very much. Next, I do have a question for our Oakland County prosecutor. Do you wish to speak prior to the lunch break, or are you willing to wait? I guess that's my question. Well, we will not be napping during the after lunch. All right. Let's bring up Charles Stimson from